We are fortunate today to have with us a pulmonologist, Dr. Navneet Singh, and a cancer surgeon, Dr. Marzi Mehta, and all treating specifically lung cancer patients. Now, one senior oncologist once said that it is all about ensuring that the right patient gets the right treatment at the right time. And I think all of us want that. We want to hear from both of you how that situation stands in India today. And what are the compatibilities between a surgeon and a physician for teaching lung cancer from the point of view of a lay person? We have these conferences where there are deliberations, but eventually it is the patient to whom they have to reach. So, Dr. Singh, what are the challenges, diagnostic and treatment challenges in India particularly? They say the five-year median survival rate is around 27% right now.
Oh, it's probably lesser than that.
Probably lesser than that. In India, it could be lesser. Maybe that's the world average. So, what would you like?
So that two or three peculiar issues. Number one is that because tuberculosis and lung cancer have overlapping symptoms, signs, and even to some extent radiological findings, I mean X-ray and CT, people who live in far-off areas and do not have access to good healthcare facilities often end up getting misdiagnosed as tuberculosis and getting treated with anti-tubercular drugs for a variable period of time and then get referred to higher centers only once there has been no response. And this leads to a delay in the diagnosis, and they often present with advanced stage in which surgery, the only modality which can lead to a cure, is not feasible at that point of time. In fact, at our center and even at other centers across the country, stage 3B and 4 will account for greater than 80% of cases, almost 85%. And that is why at that point of time, you cannot really attempt to have a cure. So that is one thing. The other thing is, even for patients in whom you find enlarged lymph nodes on imaging, you cannot be sure based on any imaging modality, whether it is CT or PET, whether these lymph nodes represent the spread of the tumor, that is metastasis, or these are due to old or active tubercular lesions. And that is why you need to access those lymph nodes in the mediastinum to take an appropriate decision.
Okay, how many patients present themselves in the stage where they can be operated upon, and what is that stage where surgery plays a big role in it?
Yes, so this is a very pertinent question, and I agree with Dr. Singh that majority of our OPD patients, that is, are mainly in the advanced disease, and they mainly, roughly around 80%, that is, would be not amenable to surgical treatment. And when we see about 100 patients, that is, we find only about 20-25 patients actually really coming up for surgery. Within that also, we would say that out of the 80, there could be other factors such as the cost associated with the surgery, the comorbidities associated with surgery. So lots of factors, that is, which actually make a surgical candidate into a non-surgical candidate. So this is where the importance of picking up early lung cancer, and which I agree completely with Dr. Singh that tuberculosis is a very large confounding factor. And I think as chest physicians and as surgeons, we collectively need to move to an era where when we have a doubt about anti-tuberculous medications not working, there should be an attempt, that is, to take a biopsy and prove the diagnosis one way or the other. Only then will we be able to really cure the stage 1 and the stage 2 lung cancers and give them a good quality of life with surgery.
Okay, so again, so the major onus is on early diagnostics, this is what I gather, and how soon and how well we can diagnose lung cancer. What are the diagnostic tools available as of now in India, and how do they compare with those available maybe in other, even the Asia Pacific region, say South Korea or Japan or other countries?
So you have a lot of modalities available for diagnosis. It all depends where the tumor is located. So somebody who has a lump in the neck, a lymph node, it is as easy to access it by a fine needle aspiration, that is an FNAC, or you could sometimes even take out the lymph node by small surgical procedure, excision biopsy. In other cases, if you have fluid in the pleural cavity, fluid outside the lungs, you can again do a needle aspiration and send it for analysis, or if required, you could do a thoracoscopy and do a thoracoscopic pleural biopsy and do the pleurodesis in the same setting. For lesions which are located close to the chest wall, you can do image guided, an ultrasound, a CT, or even a PET guided FNA or a biopsy from the lesion. And the fourth modality is for central tumors in the airways. You do a bronchoscopy and do bronchial brushing or a bronchial biopsy. And they are the different mechanisms. Even as we were discussing earlier, you can do the EBUS, the endobronchial ultrasound guided needle aspiration from the mediastinal lymph nodes. So you have a lot of different modalities available for diagnosing. The important thing is that there is no role for empirical treatment. Each and every case has to be diagnosed under a microscope. It has to be 100% confirmed by the pathologist that this is truly cancer, it is truly lung cancer. You cannot give empirical anti-cancer treatment.
These days there's a lot of talk about targeted therapies and immunotherapy. What are these available in India? And again, we are not talking of the top end hospitals, as Dr. Marzi said, that again, cost is a factor, and perhaps the treatments are available in maybe some very few locations. But where are we in terms of these new therapies?
Right, so the targeted therapies are available, and in fact, the good thing is that the EGFR TKIs, which are the most commonly used targeted drugs, at least two of them are made by several Indian companies and are very, very affordable. Immune checkpoint inhibitors have just been introduced or are going to be introduced. They are going to be prohibitively expensive as of now for majority of the population, but we assume that with passage of time they will become less expensive and maybe affordable by a greater percentage of the population.
Where do you see the role of surgery emerging more? Again, it is related to early diagnosis, but surgery versus other treatments, would you like to say something about that?
Sure. So in lung cancer, what we found now is that there is a very clear line of divide between where you can do surgery and everything else is all about Dr. Singh's immunotherapy and medical oncology, to be honest. As I said, that if we see 100 patients, only about 20-25 patients are amenable to surgery. The remaining, so basically talking about stages, stage 1 and 2 is what would technically is a broad spectrum that has come as a surgical field. Certain very selected stage 3 that is would come, that is for surgery, that also after a neoadjuvant chemotherapy, but anything beyond that would be a combination of chemotherapy, radiotherapy, immunotherapy in various combinations. And the role in palliative setting is where Dr. Singh described about medical thoracoscopy and pleurodesis is where a surgeon's role would be. Otherwise, I think lung cancer is now changing the paradigm, that is true, more and more of targeted and immunotherapy as well as the medical oncology fraternity.
I just like to add that for stages 1 to 2 and some 3A, surgery still remains the mainstay of treatment, because that is still the only modality with which you can kind of attempt to achieve a cure. The role of targeted therapies in stage 1, early stage, is not yet defined. The role of immune checkpoint inhibitors in early stage is not yet defined. And obviously, there would be people who are resectable, that means the stage is early, but who cannot have surgery because of medical reasons, that is inoperable. So you can have cases which are resectable later, inoperable, in which case you could try modalities like stereotactic body radiation to achieve a cure, or obviously give chemotherapy and or radiation. So, but still all attempts should be made to identify patients who would benefit from a surgical resection and end up getting the surgery.
What is the success cure rate in surgery? Say out of 100, you are saying 20 patients are there who can be operated upon. Amongst those, what is the cure?
As Dr. Singh very rightly pointed out, that in early cases, that is, we can get rates of as high as almost around 70 to 80% 5-year survivors in stage 1 and as high as around 60% in stage 2 lung cancer. So that is a large number when you really compare it with the quite a dismal less than 20% in the other stages. So yes, surgery does have a role, but only in very selected early lung cancer rather than in very advanced lung cancers.
So then again, as we all agreed that tuberculosis symptoms mimic lung cancer, and that is why very often diagnosis is delayed. So there has to be more perhaps openness on the part of physicians also to, as Dr. Singh said.
So I think what people need to realize is that tuberculosis is in a way confirmed. Only if you demonstrate the tubercular bacilli in sputum testing, or nowadays you have the gene expert test, which is very sensitive. So if you pick that up, then you are in a way sure you are dealing with tuberculosis. But if you have all of these negative, then rather than giving empirical anti-tubercular therapy, you should go ahead and investigate further with either a CT or an FNAC or a biopsy or a bronchoscopic procedure, whatever is required or whatever is more appropriate to make a diagnosis, because a certain percentage of these patients would probably not be tuberculosis, especially heavy smokers who come in with symptoms which mimic tuberculosis.
What are the main risk factors according to you related to lung cancer, and is it on the rise in India?
So, tobacco smoking still remains the number one risk factor for development of lung cancer. 70 to 75% of cases are attributable to that. But amongst non-smokers, you will have three or four important things. One would be passive smoking, or it is also called environmental tobacco smoke exposure. The other thing is females who live in rural areas and are using the non-LPG forms of cooking, they will have biomass fuel exposure. So that is a known risk factor, especially if the ventilation is not very good. And the third are other occupational and environmental exposures for people working in certain industries or people living in polluted areas. Of course, these are not as well defined as smoking, and these are not as easily quantifiable as smoking, but they are definitely risk factors. And along with that, you have a host of genetic factors which intermingle with the environmental factors.
We are talking of gene mutations also a lot. Means from the layperson's point of view, in how many cases do you see the cancer due to mutations in the genes or external risk factors?
So I think the question here is different. The mutations which we talk about targeting, they are acquired mutations.
Okay.
They are not present at birth, and they don't confer an increased risk of mutations. There are few genes or even a whole panel of genes which have been studied as being implicated in being posing a risk towards lung cancer, but for them there is no treatment as of now. So all the treatment what we talk of are of gene or genetic mutations which are acquired during the process the lung cancer develops.
Any gender divide in your patients? The question is to both of you. Are you getting more female lung cancer patients than male in your at your facility?
Yes, we are seeing a slightly higher preponderance with females because of the, especially in the cities where the women have taken on to smoking. But in terms of numbers, it would still far outweigh with the males, because the males have got a much higher preponderance of smoking in terms of numbers. But yes, we are seeing women also getting a higher incidence of lung cancers.
And is there any difference now? You are at PGI Chandigarh, you are here in a private hospital. What is the difference to the diagnosis and treatment in public healthcare as compared to private healthcare in India? That's a big factor, I think, for
so we get patients from different states surrounding Chandigarh, and We've seen that the profile of lung cancer at our center is different from what you see in the west of India, including Mumbai region and the south of India. So we have a greater dominance of males, squamous histology, as opposed to the west and the south of India, where you have a greater predominance of adenocarcinoma and females and non-smokers.
Any particular reason for that?
So one could be, of course, the referral bias, because females in general from very male-dominated areas tend to get less health care. And the other thing which we have postulated is, apart from all of this, is that which goes to the origins of the races, is that the origins based on Dravidian and
the Aryan.
Aryan, this thing, because we have found these differences not just for the histological type, we have found these differences even for the prevalence of EGFR mutations. That difference occurs even for that. So we believe that this could be somehow, we don't have proof of it yet, and probably we don't, there is no way to prove it, but that's one of the postulates.
Okay, what about the patient profile in your hospital? You are from the private healthcare.
Even in the private healthcare, I mean, the gender bias is not very wide, but yes, we do get more of women getting picked up, because I think more in the western part, I mean on the western side of Maharashtra and Bombay and all that, people are kind of now have taken on to the health checkups and early lung diagnosis. So lots of people, obviously, I mean, it is not really a justified element as of now that we do low dose lung cancer screening trials yet, because there is a very specific population in which you really need to do it. But just because of the sheer number of people really doing the early health checkups and all that, we are finding a lot of incidental findings also. And of course, we obviously have another population where they have been treated by many other people with for tuberculosis and for lots of diseases before they really come down. So I think I would say it's an equal kind of a preponderance, but with a slightly higher male preponderance for lung cancer as compared to the women.
Okay, now we have the SDGs, the Sustainable Development Goals, which say that we have to reduce all non-communicable diseases, including cancer, by 1/3 by 2030. What is the way forward as far as India is concerned? What would be?
If you talk of lung cancer, the first and foremost is to cut down on smoking. So smoking cessation needs to be given more emphasis, because that is the single most intervention. It would not just cut down lung cancer, it would also cut down other pulmonary diseases like COPD, IPF, it will cut down heart diseases. So with one intervention, you could end up with a lot of benefits on the healthcare side. That is the number one.
What about you, Dr. Mehta? What would you say?
Yes, I completely agree that it's, as they say, you know, if you ask me three things, it is cut down smoking. So these are only the three things which we would really put it at.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.